Good afternoon. It is 1:33 on July 15, 2015. I'm Donald Rubenstein, Jackson County Land Use Hearings Officer, and I'm conducting a file, a hearing on file 439-15-00079-ZON, which is an application for a floodplain review on property identified as 3316 West Evans Creek Road in Rogue River, and further described as tax lots 200 and 205, 36 South, Range 4 West, Section 4. The application has been submitted by Brian Barr and Geos Institute on behalf of the landowner Steve and Sharon Keaton. This is an evidentiary hearing, the purpose of which is to determine whether the applicant has presented substantial evidence in support of the application. The evidence must address and satisfy the approval criteria which have been set forth in the Planning Division staff for this, in the notice for this hearing. The approval criteria are also found in the following Jackson County Land Development section, ordinance sections, 7.2.2, 7.2.4, 7.2.7, 7.2.8, 7.2.10, 7.2.12, and 8.6.4. If you feel that other criteria apply as well, you must raise this issue to me for a ruling, and I must specifically rule that additional criteria apply before you may direct any testimony or evidence to any such new criteria. Prior to the beginning of this hearing, I have reviewed a packet of information which consists of 21 exhibits. These exhibits constitute the record in this matter to date. Evidence and testimony offered during the hearing must be directed toward the approval criteria. You must raise an issue or an objection with sufficient clarity and detail to allow the participants an opportunity to respond and to allow me to rule. Failing to do so will preclude an appeal to the Land Use Board of Appeals based on that issue. State law requires the applicant to submit all documents proposed as supporting evidence to the Planning Division prior to the hearing. If additional documents or evidence are provided in support of the application during this hearing, any participant is entitled to a continuance for at least 7 days. Prior to the conclusion of the hearing, any participant may request an opportunity to present additional evidence or testimony. And if such a request is made, I will describe the alternatives at that time. If you desire to testify, or if you are in the room, please be sure to sign the public registration sheet attached to the clipboard on the podium and provide your name and address so that we may have a complete record of those who have testified. This hearing is being recorded in the event of an appeal, in which case it may be necessary to transcribe the recording. For this reason, it is important to speak into the microphone, adjusting it before you begin. Be sure that it will pick your voice up well. Please start your testimony by introducing yourself with your name and address. And please do not make oral comments unless you are in front of the microphone. In a moment, we will commence with a report from staff on this matter. There are a couple of matters I want to place in the record prior to our beginning. Marisa Harris, my clerk, informed me that when she mailed out notices for this matter, consistent with the requirements of the Jackson County Code and the Oregon Revised Statute, she misidentified the actual number of this file. The file number is 00079, and she inadvertently identified it as 749. All other notices, that's correct. It is 00079. She inadvertently slipped the 4 in there. All other notices were proper. And with respect to my personal participation, I want to disclose that I know two people who are involved in one way or another in this application. Brian Barr, who is the applicant, is a gentleman I have met on two, perhaps three occasions. I would hardly say that we have a close personal relationship, but he is somebody whom I have met and had a conversation or two with from time to time. And secondly, the second applicant, Geos Institute, has on its board a gentleman named Ken Margolis, who is a personal friend and whom I've known for a number of years. I can assure everyone that I have had no contact with either of these people with respect to this issue, and I never will have contact with either of these people with respect to this issue. That, I believe, would be improper. It would be improper to agree that I would have to disclose it had I had such contact, but I have not had any contact, and I will not have contact with them about this matter. So, that said, I want to make one more statement, which is, this is a very particular matter. It involves the review of the application against the specific criteria set forth in section 7.2 of the Land Development Code, which is the flood overlay provision that regulates how the county reviews and determines whether a project that is in the floodplain is consistent with what turns out to be federal regulations under FEMA. I have no authority to hear or determine any issues that are beyond those criteria. And so when it comes time for either party to make a presentation before me, if your testimony or your evidence exceeds the applicable criteria, I will do my best to point it out to you. I will ask you not to proceed with that particular information. If you feel that I am mistaken in that, that there are criteria that are broad enough to allow my hearing and consideration of those matters, please let me know so that I can make a ruling as to whether you are correct or are incorrect about additional criteria. So that said, I would like to start with a presentation from staff.
Can you hear me now? All right. Thank you. This, again, is specific to the floodplain criteria in Chapter 7.2. This was for the removal of Fielder Dam and associated abandoned bridge materials and a fish ladder. And this is a fish enhancement project, and the criteria is really specific to what effect is it going to have on the floodplain, and will the applicant get the necessary permits for that removal? In essence, we don't have a lot of jurisdiction over the removal of the dam because it is within the banks of Evans Creek, and that is Department of Army Corps of Engineers, and Department of Lands, and we're specific to the effects on the floodplain as identified in the criteria. I have made findings and conclusions with respect to each of those criteria, and believe that it does meet the requirements of Section 7.2. I won't go through the each criteria as identified in the staff report and the supplemental findings. With respect to the supplemental findings, that a fish enhancement project is a type 1 review, as identified in our code. Because of
the type one review, just for everyone's understanding, is an administrative review that can be made by the staff of the county planning division across the county. Type 1 review does not involve discretion or interpretation. that's a type one review, and Mr. Madsen is saying that ordinarily a fish enhancement project is determined through a type one review.
And with respect to some of the criteria, it does fall into the type two, and we believe that was appropriate. A type two review is a review that requires notice and involves discretion, as the hearings officer has indicated, because it will alter the stream. It will be a removal of some materials in the stream, and so staff thought it was appropriate to make this a type two review with the opportunity for notice to the property owners in the city.
And a type two review requires interpretation of the code, and procedurally it differs from a type one review in that it is made by staff, and it results in a specific written decision that addresses the findings, and it is subject to appeal upon its completion. And that's the procedure that has been followed here, which is why we have an appeal hearing.
And with that, I'll ask the hearings officer if you have any questions at this time regarding the staff report.
At the moment, I have a very limited question. There is a requirement in the code that other agencies of permitting jurisdiction or regulatory jurisdiction be provided notice and that the applicant has secured permits from those other agencies that have such regulatory jurisdiction. I would like you to identify which those agencies are, if they were notified, and if any such permits have been issued by them.
As far as the notifying agencies, the applicant has already notified Department of State Lands, Army Corps of Engineers, Department of Environmental Quality,
Fish and Wildlife?
Fish and Wildlife, yes, has.
And is it state or federal or NIMS or what?
NIMS has been involved in the process. This has been going on for quite a while as far as the preparation for the application, and they have been involved in this, and we haven't gotten any of the permits as yet, and so the project cannot be initiated until those permits are obtained.
And have the permits from those agencies been applied for?
Yes. And I believe the applicant will be addressing that issue. But my understanding is that they have been applied for.
And I noticed in the record that staff did independently provide notice to Army Corps and to ESL, I think it was, on its own initiative, correct?
Yes.
I do not have further questions at the moment.
I do have a question, and it's a question that I certainly do not want to offend you about. And I would like to ask it to you. You started off the meeting very eloquent, and to me, you had full disclosure with a couple of individuals. I would like to ask you if, in the Southern Oregon Land Conservancy program, or CUB, or whatever that is, have you ever had any contact with Mr. Bob Hunter? Are you and Mr. Bob Hunter friends?
Mr. Kroom, I have made disclosures that are both required by law and are honest and complete.
Okay.
Whatever contact I may have had with Mr. Hunter isn't relevant to this matter because he's not a party to this matter.
Okay.
He's not an applicant, and he doesn't appear in any of the filings. He may very well have participated in the work to remove this dam, but he's not a party, he's not an applicant. Now, having said that, I will tell you, and I have no obligation to tell you, and in fact, you have failed in your decision, in your purpose in not offending me, I will tell you that. I do know Mr. Hunter. Occasionally, I have met him perhaps four times. I am not a personal friend of his, and he, this relationship bears absolutely no bearing on my decision.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I'm sorry if I didn't.
Apology accepted. So with that, I'm going to call for a presentation by the applicant, please.
Good afternoon.
Meet again?
Yes. I'm Laura Fady, Craig Law Center. Address is 917 Southwest Oak Street, Suite 417, Portland, Oregon, 97205.
And as you speak, let me ask Mrs. Harris to see whether the recorder is picking her voice up adequately. It is? Okay, thank you.
So I'm here today to ask on behalf of the applicant, Brian Barr, and Geos Institute, that the hearing officer approve this application for a floodplain development permit for the removal of the older dam. I'll just give a brief overview of the background of this project. Removal of the Fielder Dam has been identified as a priority for the recovery of Endangered Species Act listed coho salmon to provide improved fish passage, as well as for steelhead, cutthroat trout, chinook salmon, as well as sucker lamprey. This is one part of a two dam removal project on Evans Creek, a tributary to the Rogue River. And ODFNW has ranked this dam as fourth of its most significant barriers to fish passage statewide. Once this project is completed, it will open up Evans Creek to fish passage, including 19 miles for chinook, 60 miles for coho, and 70 miles for steelhead. The applicant and its partners have received broad support for this project from state and federal agencies. They've secured funding in excess of $400,000 for the studying and implementation of this project, including applying for all the relevant applications. Funding has come from the Oregon Watershed Enhancement Board, ODFNW, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, as well as several foundation and nonprofit organizations. And many of these organizations have also provided letters in support of this project, including Water Resources Department and the Department of Environmental Quality. The landowners of the dam site and the properties that will be used to access the removal project have entered into an agreement that allow the removal, and they agree to cooperate in securing all of the necessary permits and the removal process itself.
Let me ask you one question,
yes,
which is more of curiosity than of legal importance, which is, do the Keatons own the dam because I'm assuming they own to the center of the river? Is that?
So tax lot 200 covers nearly the entire from both sides of the river where the dam is located. And then 204, tax lots 204 and 205 are the other properties they own. 204 will be used for access to the side of the dam where the removal occur from that point.
So is it the Keatons who own the dam?
Yes. And the landowner agreement that they entered into is attached with my submissions that I'll be putting in today.
So that'll be new in the record. I haven't seen that.
Okay. And there are no other rights that are associated with the dam, including water rights. And that has been affirmed by the Water Resources Department. And I'm also attaching a letter that explains that with my written testimony. The applicant has put in significant time, money, and effort for the preparation of this project since 2013 or even earlier. They've hired River Design Group as a professional engineer to conduct engineering design for removal, sediment sampling, as well as fish passage and restoration plans that are required to meet all of the permit requirements for the various permits that they were applying for. All necessary permits have been applied for and are expected to be issued in the very near future. And also submitting proof of the DSL permit that has already been secured, as well as recognition from the Army Corps of Engineers and the Department of Environmental Quality that those applications have been submitted. There are contracting bids that are already in place, and the project is set to move forward this summer. During the in-water work window, which begins today, June 15th, and ends on September 15th. If the project is not able to move forward this year, the applicant may face higher bid prices, as well as greater material and implementation costs in 2016.
What is the in-water time anticipated for the project to take?
Approximately 4 to 5 weeks.
Okay, thank you.
And another year of this dam remaining in place means another year of impaired fish passage on Evans Creek. The Weimer Dam, which is also going to be removed, is actually upstream of the Fielder Dam, and that one is slated to be removed this summer, but its success depends in substantial part on the removal of the Fielder Dam as well. So timely resolution of this appeal is of the utmost importance to the applicant as they look to complete the project this year. So the applicant has met its burden in demonstrating the relevant criteria that are met through the technical memorandum that was submitted into the record. That's at page, beginning at page 56. As you stated, there's a limited set of very specific criteria that apply to this application.
I mean, the memo that you are talking about is Mr. Wright's?
Yes.
The engineers?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
River Design Group did this hydraulic modeling study that's in the record, and that demonstrates the compliance with each of the individual criteria that are excellent here. And I'm going to ask Mr. Wright to come up now and explain the specific technical criteria in the modeling that was done.
Will you be back after his presentation?
Yes.
Thanks. Go ahead, Mr. Wright.
Great, thank you. My name is Scott Wright with River Design Group, and we are the consultants to provide the technical background and information for the Fielder Dam Removal Project. And so that's what I would like to talk about, give you a brief overview of our technical findings and efforts that we put into demonstrating that this project meets the intent of the land development ordinance. So to start it off with, I want to point out that the section 7.2 is the floodplain overlay ordinance. And in there, the purpose of that ordinance is to promote public health, safety, and general welfare of the citizenry. I am a professional engineer. I take an oath as a professional engineer, and it is my duty as well, as you see in the Oregon administrative rules, that my primary obligation is to protect the safety, health, property, and welfare of the public. So you can see that my duties and obligations line up very well with the 7.2 floodplain overlay the county has. So with that responsibility, you also have to have experience. And dam removal is a unique venture that not many people have experience in. However, we happen to have a lot of experience. Our firm and myself, we have projects throughout the Northwest, including Oregon, Washington, Idaho, in Montana that we have performed work on for dam removals. And in Oregon in particular, we have over 25 projects that we've worked on here, with several of them being in the Rogue Valley, which you're familiar with. But to help us get closer and zoom in a little bit with the experience and work that's been done in the Rogue Valley, we have multiple dam removals that have happened here. You can see the dates on each of those dam removals. The Savage Rapids Dam, the Gold Hill Dam, and the Gold Ray Dam were all in the main stem Rogue River. And then probably two that you aren't familiar with, but have been done as well in 2002 and 1999 on Evans Creek in the upper part of the watershed, the Maple Gulch Dam and the Alfonso Dam. And so I'm not going to talk about any of those projects other than that they were all held to pretty high standards and we have a pretty significant database of information to pull from to help us inform what we're doing, since our project, in this case, Fielder Dam and Weimer Dam, we're only talking about the Fielder Dam, but it's sandwiched right in the middle of essentially all of those past projects that have happened already. So now finally getting to the Fielder Dam in particular, this is an aerial view from just not too long ago showing the concrete structure and the reservoir. It has a very long linear reservoir, and the concrete structure is pretty old, as it dates back into the 30s, and before that there was a structure there as well, Log Creek Dam that was there. So talking about the section 7.2, the floodplain overlay, I just highlighted it.
Get you to hold on just a second, because I'm trying to keep all your pages in order here, and they're not numbered for me, and I really don't want to get them out of order. I still remember which you presented, first, second, and third.
So we're working our way from the top, kind of drilling into where we're at the Fielder Dam.
I figured that. So just a second.
So we start with the state of Oregon.
That's okay. Sorry. Hang on just a second. These are the copies I'm going to be working from. So.
Okay.
One. Next. Hang on. Make sure I get that back again, please. Oh, that's one. Hang on a second. So this is one. Two. Which is two? Which was one?
That's one.
Yeah.
These are two.
Oh, that's why I'm never going to get this right. Thank you. So they're two per page. Okay. Three, four. Mm-hmm. Where was this one?
Keep that one. Hold on to that one. This is the next thing. So this is four.
Yeah.
So three, four, five, six.
Yep.
So I've got a few jokes if you want some jokes.
No, I think we're not going to complicate things. I won't be able to give your jokes appropriate attention, and I would hate to insult you. So,
would you like me to start over?
No, I don't think that's necessary. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I feel like I'm, looks Dick C. Jane back in grade school here. 19. Backside 11, 12.
Getting serious now.
It's too hot. Me, anyway. So here it comes. Thank you, Mr. Wright. I am ready for you now.
So
I'm on slide five.
We're looking at a dam, that's right. So you know I've got a little bit of experience. You know that experience lines up very well with the requirements.
Yeah, remember the content.
What's in the floodplain overlay requirements in the land development ordinance. And so now we're going to start talking a little bit more detail about the actual Fielder Dam and the analysis that we did to look at the Fielder Dam. And in section 7.2, I just summarized a couple of the items out of there from the objectives. And that is, again, kind of reiterating the protecting human life, health, and property, which is part of our obligation as professional engineers. And then also, I found an interesting one out of there was to minimize the impact of development on the natural and beneficial functions of the floodplain. And so we're really calling this development in this situation, but it's really trying to renaturalize and restore the river back to a natural condition rather than developing the river.
And development is a term that comes from Chapter 13 definitions in the Land Development Ordinance, and it is development in that definition.
And Section 7.21D talks about methods of reducing flood losses, and one of those ways of reducing losses is to restore natural floodplains and stream channels. And that's really what we're doing. That's our primary objective here for the Fish Passage in removing a dam out of the middle of the river, is to help restore those natural floodplains and stream channel conditions. So moving into the actual criteria that we're trying to address with specific information, 7.27 talks about development will not diminish the carrying capacity of the water course. And we have a memo that was submitted with our Type 2 permit applications to Jackson County and Mike that demonstrates through there in a couple different ways how we do not diminish the carrying capacity of the channel by removing a concrete structure out of the river. And one of those ways was through a hydraulic model. And this is standard operation for anybody doing river restoration and or dam removal, is to use typically at a minimum a one-dimensional model or a two-dimensional model. In this case, a one-dimensional model was more than adequate for this situation, where we used the standard TECRAS model. And there you can see this is a plan view. We're looking from an airplane down onto the site with the Fielder Dam on the left. All of those numbered sections there are cross sections that were within our geometric model that was used. You can see that the cross sections are condensed, and there's quite a few of them, more of them down close to the dam, and then they spread out as they go up the reservoir. And you can see that it goes, hydraulic model goes all the way up to the extents of the reservoir and then some upstream and downstream, so that it's outside the influence of the dam that's there today.
Question for you before you move on, and maybe you're going to answer it, which is to the extent that it would help my understanding, and I do not desire to become a hydraulic engineer in the process of this, but what are the criteria standards generally? What are you looking at when you set these cross sections? How is it that you determine where it is appropriate to establish a cross section?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, actually, and that's one that hydraulic modelers wrestle with quite a bit. There's some model limitations, and that's one of the first criteria that we use. If you are losing a lot of energy, or you have a steep stream where you're losing a foot of elevation every 100 feet or so, then you have to have closer cross sections. If you have a flat gradient type stream system, you can have them spaced out further apart. So this is kind of a double-edged sword here when you're dealing with a reservoir, because a reservoir is extremely flat. In this case of Fielder Dam, it's completely flat for a mile upstream. And so we could, to look at the existing conditions, we could space out the cross sections significantly further than they could be once the dam is out and is restored to a natural channel. However, to do a better job for our post-dam removal hydraulic model, we space them very closely together. And so since the Evans Creek, we were able to fly LIDAR, and you're getting into the minutia here, but I'll give it to you. We were able to fly in an airplane over the top and get LIDAR data, which is basically information that's collected on a 1 foot or 2 foot square throughout the entire watershed. That from the Rogue River all the way up past the Weimer Dam for over 10 miles of river. When you have that type of density of ground information, then you can have a higher density of cross sections as well with better assurance. And so since we had that much information for the ground contours, we were able to tighten up the cross sections. So we did a pretty tight hydraulic model.
And that I'm inferring that tighter cross sections yields more data and yields more precise modeling. Is that correct?
No, it can't. Garbage in equals garbage out. If you start with garbage, you're not going to make it any better if you take more cross sections. The reality is, in order to do an excellent hydraulic model, you have to have good ground field truthing and good ground data. And so one of the things that we do is we fly LIDAR, and then we come behind that with our GPS and survey grade instruments and go through and actually survey the ground to confirm what we had from that initial LIDAR model. And so we do that through ground truthing. And so that is how you do a better model, is you have better real world data.
And you're saying you did ground proofing?
Absolutely. And then the second thing that can give you a better hydraulic model is through calibration of the model. Anybody that gives you a hydraulic model that's not calibrated is oftentimes wasting your time. And the way that you calibrate the hydraulic model is by having a known water surface elevations and multiple water surface elevations and known discharges. And that's something that we did both upstream and downstream of the dam, knowing what the discharge was, knowing what the water surface was, so that we can plug in real world values and run those in our model and make sure that our model hits what's really out there today. And so we were able to do that as well. And kind of the third thing to wrap up your hydraulic model question is that there are certain standards that we have to meet for the letter of map revision, LOMER, that's by FEMA. And they have very specific error checking that you have to do in your hydraulic model. So our hydraulic model was set up to meet those requirements for error checking once we actually go to the point where we have to do a LOMER. And so our model is set up from the beginning to kill multiple objectives or meet multiple objectives down the road, not so much to analyze the existing conditions, but to see what's going to happen down the road. Does that help you out?
It helps me out a lot to clarify to the extent that I can, and I'm going to try not to speak beyond my understanding. LOMER is a letter of map revision. It is one of the mechanisms by which adopted floodplain mapping, which is done by FEMA and is required of all local jurisdictions who have land within the floodplain, a LOMER, letter of map revision, is one of the devices that FEMA uses in order to revise an adopted floodplain map.
That's correct. Yep. And I'll talk on those on LOMERs a little bit more as we go down through this. But one of the things that jumped out at you, obviously, from the hydraulic modeling, is that you have this big obstruction in the river, and then once you take that out, you have significant drops in your water surface elevation. So this comparison that you see here is looking at about a mile of the river with Fielder Dam located on the left of this map, this figure, and you can see in the red dots on the top that says existing floodplain elevation, and then in the blue is the future after the dam is out. And what we're seeing, we have tabular data, and this picture is also in the report that was submitted to Jackson County on January 26th. And in table 2 of that report, you can see the exact difference in elevations. And the water surface elevations that we're seeing are on the order of about 7 feet lower in and around the dam, and then they just reduce from there. So they start out matching at the downstream end, and then they match at the upstream end, so that we're outside the zone of influence of the dam. And then with the dam gone, you can see them matching at the same locations as well.
Couple questions, please.
Yep.
So you are saying that the maximum decrease in floodplain elevation is about 7 feet with the removal of the dam?
Correct, and that's a comparison of the 100-year peak flow to the 100-year peak flow. So it's the same amount of flow in both scenarios. We simply change the geometry of the hydraulic model.
And is that water level what's commonly referred to as the base flood elevation?
However, for this particular area, there is no base flood elevation established.
Correct.
This is a zone that is a zone A that does not have elevations established.
Second question for you before we move off this slide is, what is the dashed black line that is just below the current height of the dam?
Excellent job.
I'm halfway down.
Yes, excellent job. Excellent eyes to notice that. So what is that dashed line there in the middle of the picture? What that is we have made an estimate of what we expect for sediment evacuation once the dam is removed. So we have the dam that's there today, and the sediment is filling up the dam and the reservoir completely. Interestingly enough, if you look on the design report, and I was going to save this for later, but I'll throw it out there now for
Before you do that, I want to be clear because I'm not. That black line, dashed line, represents what you project to be the current level of sediment that's trapped behind the dam?
So we don't predict or project. We know what the current sediment level is behind the dam.
And that is it,
you're saying? And that is it. That's why you see it's a wavy line, because we know exactly what the elevation of the sediment is behind that dam.
And that comes from your LIDAR data?
No, that comes from our ground survey of the site. And we were able to walk. It's very shallow out there. It's 2 feet, 3 feet deep in most places at this time of the year.
So let me do a brief calculation here. It looks like something on the order of a range of essentially 0 to about 10 feet of depth of sediment?
A little bit more than that. It's actually closer to 15 feet. If you look on this end down here, this area in here is going to be closer to the 15-foot range in this area. And so one of the important things about this, and this is very rare that we have such great fortune to have something from the past history of this dam, but if you look at our design report that was submitted with this application to Mr. Mattson already, in the design report, which you have a copy of, on page 7, figure 3-2 shows a copy of the ground contours there from 1934, and something significant.
This is a data table?
It's actually a figure in the design report.
And what figure number is it again?
3.2, 3-2.
Mr. Mattson, what record number would that be? Do you know?
It says design report fish passage plan.
Yeah, but I need to find it by.
And the technical memorandum, what page was your page?
It's not in the technical memorandum, it's
okay.
In the designer.
Designer. Okay.
Is the design report in the record, Mr. Mattson?
I only see the technical memorandum.
All right, so Ms. Fahey says that the technical memorandum, the design report, is that the proper term?
Design report
that Mr. Wright is referring to has not yet been provided in the record, but it's going to be submitted. But so you are referring me to...
So you don't need to have it necessarily to get Mr. Wright saying
that. That's just as well, because I don't...
So my point is that we were very fortunate on this project, and we were able to find some existing topography information of when they went in and actually built the concrete dam. This original dam was a timber crib structure that was blown out, and they came back in 1934 and reconstructed it with a concrete structure that you see out there today. When they did that, they actually surveyed the site. So they did a land survey, which was extremely valuable to us because we were able to take that historical topography and place it over our proposed project and see very clearly where the historical channel was before the dam was put in there. And so that information on how did you come up with the slope and the sediment evacuation, that was done based on historical 1934 topography of where the channel was located from that survey. And so that now will be part of the document that you can look at as well. But some pretty neat, interesting old photos and information that you just generally don't get with a project like this. What that helped us identify, though, was bedrock in the location of bedrock. And bedrock is our friend when we start talking about dam removals. And so then we can start to really hone in and know exactly where the channel is going to be after the dam comes out, and then also where this elevation in here, where that line is going to end up as well, as a result of looking at the rock and the grade control features that were there.
So in that figure, the bottom solid black line is essentially the floor of the river beneath the water level?
It's an approximate location of the bottom of the channel.
Correct.
And it's more bedrock features that were identified. And we did quite a bit of field verification of this as well, to go around with like a 6-foot steel bar and probing throughout the entire area to identify where bedrock features were located and survey those in, and so that's how we ended up with the alignment. So we have pretty good confidence in the location and what we ended up with.
Thank you.
So that's what we used for our hydraulic model in the sense of what we looked at for the proposed conditions after hand. In continuing on forward with the criteria, the 7.27 talks about relocation, alteration of the stream channel or water course is prohibited unless an applicant submits written verification from ODFW that will have minimum fish impacts to fish habitat. Obviously, this is a fish enhancement project. One of the things that Maura alluded to earlier is that we've had a multi-agency team, whether it was the National Marine Fisheries Service, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife Service. All of the fisheries agencies have been involved with this project and have supported it. And Dan Van Dyke with ODFW, the fish biologist here, the district biologist for ODFW, provided the letter with that verification. Dan was busy writing lots of letters and also wrote a letter in approval of the riparian plans, demonstrating that altering the riparian, that we have a plan in place to help improve that as well. One interesting thing that I throw out there, this is Savage Rapids Dam after removal. And you can see that there was nothing done for the riparian in this particular area, where you can see that it's encroached and recolonized at a lower level and continue to improve each and every year as things continue to unfold on the Savage Rapids Dam. The interesting thing about dams and dam removals is that we're essentially uncovering things, in this case, that have been covered with water for 100 years, and there's a seed bed, there's structures under there, wood structures that start to come out, and it starts to be beneficial as far as from a floodplain standpoint and a vegetation recolonization standpoint. The stuff is there, it just needs to be exposed from the water. Looking at section 7.2.7, this gets back to your question about the permits that have been applied for, and we have applied for the federal, state, and county permits. The state is the Division of State Lands, they've already given us approval. DEQ, we have verification, it'll be submitted. Fish passage plan by ODFW has already been approved and recognized. At the federal level, we have the NEPA, SHPO, Army Corps. Those have all been applied for. NEPA's been essentially approved, and SHPO's been approved. Now we're waiting, Army Corps is waiting for the fees to be paid to DEQ, and they will be providing us a permit as well.
SHPO is a state agency, State Historic Preservation Office?
That's correct. Working in tandem with the federal, at the federal level. And then moving along at the different agencies that need to be notified. Obviously, we had an interagency team that's been working on this for a year and a half plus. And so all of the agencies were notified through those multiple meetings that we had with them. In addition, there are no adjacent communities that need to be notified from a floodplain management standpoint. So there's nothing there. And then Jackson County has notified FEMA already and DLCD as part of their floodplain planning as well. Continuing down in 7.27F, we have to be responsible for maintenance and making sure that we don't diminish the carrying capacity. We have an approved monitoring and adaptive management plan that was approved by National Marine Fisheries Service, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and ODFW. This was primarily set up for fish passage because they're more concerned about fish being able to move through here. However, if fish can move through here, then obviously the carrying capacity of the channel is acceptable. And so this maintenance and monitoring plan is in place and will be part of the requirements that we have moving forward with monitoring the site after the dam is removed and meets the requirements for the county. And then 7.28, talking about letter of map revision, which we've talked about before. The important thing is that we've done these before. We've had two letters of map revisions approved by the Jackson County already, one for the Gold Ray Dam and one for a Little Butte at the Denman Wildlife Area, that have gone through the process, and Jackson County has accepted those as well as FEMA. We've done those, and we're prepared and ready to do one for this project here.
And as I recall from the code, from the LDO,
Yep. That
is a requirement imposed upon you within a particular period of time following...
6 months.
Following removal, is
That's
that correct?
Right. Yep. 6 months. And we are prepared to move forward with that as soon as the dam is removed. We had a similar stipulation with the Gold Ray project, which we were able to meet as well. The floodplain or floodway development, this talks about fish enhancement projects that you need to have a professional engineer provide calculations to make sure that you're they're not having a net rise in the floodplain elevation, that no structures would be impacted, in an agreement to monitor the project, which we meet all three of those criteria. I have provided you the memo, and we've covered that enough. And there's also within that memo that you already have talks about the structures and how far away they are and how high above the floodplain they are, and they're significantly out of the way is the bottom line. And then finally, the agreement, we just talked about that, for monitoring is in place and has been approved already. And then moving into section 7212, zones without base flood elevations. And this is where we do not have a base flood elevation established for this particular area. Just downstream from the dam at the junction of Fielder Creek and Evans Creek, elevations are established, but up here they are not. And so we are...
And this is a FEMA function, is that correct?
That's correct. They just haven't done any modeling up through here.
Go ahead.
And so when we don't have base flood elevations, then we have to provide, that our proposed development will be safe from flooding and won't cause problems. And that's what we have provided for you in the technical memorandum that was provided already, showing that we're having a net lowering of the floodplain and that the structures in and around are outside of the floodplain and won't be harmed. So,
Question for you, please.
Yes.
Clarification, please. You said in areas without base flood elevations, you have to calculate them.
Yep.
Which you have done, I presume, consistently with the technical requirements.
Correct.
And you used a term here that I don't know how to understand, which is you need, roughly you said, to do it in such a way that it won't cause problems.
Right.
What kind of problems does this process concern itself with that your technical analysis is supposed to prevent?
That's a very good question. So the problems that you're trying to avoid is that if somebody came in and did made a recommendation on the floodplain width, and they did it without a hydraulic model, that would be a good example of a problem that you wouldn't want to deal with. And so the criteria has very specific requirements, and it says that the floodplain is going to be minimum of 50 feet or whatever the channel width is. And in this case, we calculated the channel width to be 140 feet in here based on our hydraulic model, and that's what we went with for our floodway. And so we used a large floodway, and at the same time, we have a map that shows the structures, their location, and how high above the floodplain they are.
Structures, you mean?
Houses is what we're talking about. And so if you look on figure 2 of the technical memorandum, which you have in your possession, you can see there a description of the structures, the houses, and also the explanation of how we determine the floodway.
And that's on record page 58. And it appears that no structures were identified as being of concern, if I'm correct.
That's
on
correct.
The east side of the channel?
That's correct.
Just, it looks like three on the west side?
That's correct.
And why those and not other structures on the west side?
Well, why those is because they're around the area of the greatest change in the floodplain elevation, and the floodway is the largest. And there are no other structures further up along the reservoir there. And so that's why those were the primary ones. There are some houses just upstream, but they are not going to be adversely affected by the removal of the dam.
So first an assumption, which is that the floodplain above the dam is going to decrease, and I think you've already established that in your prior testimony.
Correct.
But here we identify two structures that are either essentially just at or somewhat downstream of the dam. What happens to the floodplain in those locations, the locations downstream of the dam?
Yeah, that's a good question too. The downstream of the dam, the floodplain's not going to change because, first of all, that's down. Our model extends further downstream than this, but downstream is where we're tying into the existing ground, and the floodplain has not changed down there. And I don't want to get into too much hydraulic modeling lingo, but essentially what we have here is a subcritical conditions when you're at a 100-year event. So that means that your downstream boundary condition, in this case the river, is controlling what happens in the floodplain. And so we are not changing anything in that downstream area. So the two structures that we show downstream, are nothing changes down there. We're simply showing those as the most relevant and closest structures to the system.
Yeah, and you basically used them to assess your compliance with this criterion as to whether you were going to create any problems.
Adverse effects.
Does your, do the criteria, either these in the code or FEMS criteria, require you to assess or determine other possible adverse effects? And I know it has to do with stream biology, fish health, all that stuff, but other potential adverse effects besides the biological ones?
No, actually, it doesn't even address the biological. So FEMA and the floodplain administrator for the county, they only care about floodplains. They don't care about necessarily biological components as much.
And that's Fish and Wildlife that cares
about
that.
And so they're more interested in safety and the health in humans than they are about biological. So we're held to a different standard when we're talking about floodplains and floodways, as far as it's not about fish passage at that point.
Thank you. Valley morphology,
so
slide 18, actually.
Continuing on slide 18 there, valley morphology, this is looking from upstream. You can see the dam there in the middle of the picture and the reservoir. And I want to briefly touch on some importance, and this is getting back to what the question that you just asked about what do you feel is being significant upstream as far as potential problems. And this is why we didn't focus on it, because based on our historical review of channel locations, based on the valley morphology, this here is a view. You can see the dam down here at the downstream end of this slide, or the upper part of the slide.
Background in the slide.
Yes. I have a red dashed line, and this is a cross-section. And this cross-section is shown down here. And what you can see, West Evans Creek Road is over here on the right. And you can see here the ordinary high water. And you can see this is the lowest part of the valley as well. And so once this dam is taken out, this is going to continue to be lower over here. And we're not going to be able to all of a sudden jump over to West Evans Creek Road or somewhere else, because this is the lowest spot in the valley. And it becomes very critical when you start to look even further upstream. You can see it even more so. And you can see this is looking upstream in this area here for a cross section, and this cross section is actually mirrored, so it's actually you're looking downstream. But you can see West Evans Creek Road. You can see that this isn't much of a floodplain over here. It's very high. That's the ordinary high water. And then you can see the existing channel location here with a yearly flood showing in it. And this is will continue to drop, if anything, and that's pretty much anchored where it's at as far as location.
It's going to continue to drop in elevation just because of the river erosive effect of the river?
That's correct. And then also the lack of a big grade control structure downstream, namely a dam.
Okay. Hang on one second, please.
So that really starts to look at the question of how far did we look up. We looked at the entire reservoir upstream and the entire valley to look across the whole valley cross section to see where it is anticipated that the channel would end up in a, as it evolves over time. So and then looking at section 7212, which is
in, hang on for me, okay. Please. Slide 21, 7.2.12.
Yeah, this is just getting kind of wrapping things up with the areas without base flood elevations, which we talked about. And the floodplain administrator can accept an Oregon Registered Professional Engineer's interpretation of where that is, and also that we have to demonstrate that it's not going to increase the base flood elevation that we determined more than 1 foot. And obviously with the dam removal taking a very large chunk of concrete out of the river, it's going to be a lowering of the base flood elevation out there. And we've demonstrated that through the hydraulic modeling and other reports that have been submitted to you. So in just wrapping it up, dam removal is a fish enhancement project and is allowed within the floodway, within the land development ordinance of Jackson County. And then this project, like past dam removal projects in the county, meets the floodplain overlay requirements. And then finally, we've submitted documentation, technical reports, registered professional engineer seal on the reports that these meet the requirements for the land development ordinance section 7.2.
Thank you. Hold on, let me see if I have any other questions for you. I may have asked all the questions that I had just in the course of your presentation. In the application, which I know you did not prepare, it represents the dam does not alter the hydrology of Evans Creek to any large degree. Can you explain,
yes, in
more layman terms, what that means and whether it increases, decreases, or has no effect on the possibility of erosion or other, adverse conditions upstream?
Yeah, absolutely. So when we say hydrology, we're talking about rainfall, we're talking about atmospheric conditions, it could be snowfall and snowpack. Hydrology is the water regime that's in the river and coming through the system. Fielder Dam is what we would consider a run-of-the-river dam. It does not hold water, store water, it is not meant to store water. What the purpose of Fielder Dam was is to increase the height of the water so that it could be diverted for irrigation. It's not there to necessarily store water. And so when you take a winter storm event or a winter flood, all of the water that comes into the dam area goes out. And when you take that dam out, the same thing happens. All the water that comes in goes out. What you could do or what will happen to some degree is that the energy changes to some degree, the way the energy is transferred through the system. And what I mean by that is that right now you have a flat, cool area where the water comes in and is essentially stagnant or slow, and is slowed down. But at the same time, the sediment comes into that area and drops out as well. So you fill in with sediment, and then you can still get erosion on the sides of the river in this condition. It's just not as common because the vegetation is all there, and in this case, the water doesn't fluctuate very much. When you take the dam out, you're going to have that sediment come out, and you're going to have a new water level, a new elevation of the water surface. And the vegetation is also going to change elevations and start to encroach down the banks. And so the hydrology doesn't change, but the actual reservoir area is going to change.
So the hydrologic characteristics of the river will essentially remain the same, but what's going to differ, what's going to change, three things that I can think of, is water level, the floor of the river to the extent that now it is full of sediment and over time after the removal of dam it will not be.
Yep.
And third is vegetation on the banks.
Yeah, almost, you're almost there. We got one more that I would throw in there. And this here is a picture from just the other day. And you can see right in the middle of the dam, there's a continuity of sediment and wood and natural processes that are not happening right now. You have the sediment being trapped. You have, in this case, large wood getting hung up. And whose problem does this become? Now we've got a hazard out there for people. And so we have a discontinuity in the river system here. And when that's gone, that natural processes can happen, which helps your flooding concerns overall for the natural drainage corridor.
It relieves flooding concerns, you're saying?
Absolutely. So we don't have this big magnet out there collecting wood and other problems. And it's consistent with the floodplain overlay restoring natural systems.
So when, and you may not know the answer to this question, but if the dam were to be removed and the level of Evans Creek dropped, the project is going to revegetate certain portions of the exposed bank over time. Will there be areas that are exposed that the project will not be revegetating? And how will those get revegetated?
That's correct. That there are potentially areas that would not be immediately vegetated. And the bottom line is, based on our experience, is that you don't know which areas won't revegetate on their own or colonize on their own. It's going to depend on the soil characteristics. One of the problems that we have here in the Evans Creek is that we have a lot of really clean sand and gravel. There are very few nutrients in it. And so vegetation does not necessarily grow real well in the river environment here, where you have clean and sterile gravels and sands. And so in this case here, we have a planting plan for the areas that we're disturbing in and around the dam. And as you go upstream, that's private property outside of our area, and they will naturally recolonize to some degree, but there are areas that may not. And so what I would say to that is that, there are programs available, soil water conservation districts, other agencies around that are more than happy to plant trees in these areas like that, and shrubs, and work with people to help them revegetate their areas.
So for private landowners above the revegetation area that this project is going to address, there are resources available to them to assist them revegetating their banks?
That's correct. And then again, I kind of come back to this picture here on the Rogue River, Savage Rapids Dam, where nothing has been done whatsoever on this other side or this side. You can see the amount of vegetation that's encroached, but it's not encroached very much over here. This is primarily more of a sandy area over here. But this is a rocky and exposed area that has actually encroached very well as far as the willows and cottonwoods. And so the recolonization depends on the soil types, the seedbed, the type of year that we have from a hydrologic standpoint. There's a lot of factors that go into how something is actually going to revegetate after dam removal.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wright. That is my questions for the moment. I just want to make sure the record is complete and accurate with respect to the fulfillment of those requirements. So, as long as it's in the record, or you want to point me to places in the record, or you're going to provide additional information or things that aren't in the record.
I'll submit a written testimony that points to specific record pages, as well as includes the design report that was mentioned, and other receipts verifying that the applications have been submitted for other permits.
Okay, and I suppose a question that is important to ask is, for those required permits that have not yet been issued by whatever agencies may have that jurisdiction, those jurisdictions, what is the probability that they will issue permits for this? I mean, if we have conditions of approval that require securing permits, those conditions have to be feasible to be met, and I'm testing feasibility here.
Yes. I'm going to have Brian Barr address that.
You can do that now or whenever in your presentation you want to, so that's up to you. I don't want to disrupt your presentation any more than I always do.
It's okay, you want to just briefly address the permit applications that are moving
around? So, Brian Barr, 89 Alger Street, Central Point, Oregon, 97502. So all the permits that Scott mentioned in his report, Scott Wright mentioned in his report, have been applied for 6 to 7 months ago. And we're expecting all of those to be issued by the end of the month of June. Department of State Lands is the only one we have in hand. But the rest, it's sort of like dominoes, and once they start falling, they tend to drop pretty quick.
By the end of this month?
That's my expectation.
Thank you.
And I'll just reserve further
comments
for.
Okay.
But unless there's any other questions.
No, thank you. I don't have questions at the moment. It's a rarity, isn't it? And Mr. Barr, did you have any additional comments you wanted to make because you signed up? Okay, that's it. Bob Hunter?
No comment.
Bob Hunter does not want to add anything. Kent Knock, did you want to make comments here? Okay. You sure they address the applicable criteria, please, and state your name and address for the record first.
My name is Kent Knock. I live at 2583 East Evans Creek Road, Rogue River, 97537.
And what I'm going to do, I haven't discussed this before, but can you put that in for me, please? The applicant and the appellant are not limited in the amount of time that they have to make a presentation, but generally members of the public are limited to 3 minutes apiece, and I'm going to impose that on everybody equally. And we have this series of lights up here, and there's also a clock right there by your left hand, which will call out the time from start to finish, and when you get to about a minute, I will give you a heads up.
Don't worry, I have irrigation to do.
Okay, you're on, sir. Go ahead, please.
Actually, our irrigation withdrawal point is a couple thousand feet down from this dam, and it's on the address of 2577 East Evans Creek Road, and I see no adverse effects possible from removal of this dam on our operation. The bottom of the creek is pretty much rock. It's with a little bit of sand on top of it. And There are some beavers. Every once in a while we see fish. We'd like to see more fish. And I believe that the data that was presented earlier shows that we don't have to worry about increasing flooding. So that's great. I see the possibility that we'll see more fish, which that may not be relevant to the floodplain, but I think it's a good thing. And if the criteria are met, this seems to me to be a function of government to promote the common good. And I think that increasing the fish population in this stream is the public good. And the dam itself has really no positive function. I don't believe anybody's irrigating out of this reservoir. So I think that its time has passed. So I recommend that you guys don't waste any time either. I'm done. I'll get that minute back.
Thank you. If I'm reading this sign-up sheet properly, there is no one else who has indicated they support the application and wants to speak. Is that correct? Is there anyone who I've not called upon? Before I call upon the appellants for a presentation, there's one individual who wishes to speak who is neutral, and I think it's within my discretion. I think this is probably as good a place to hear from him as any. Steve Rowe, do you want to make any comments, sir?
Actually, if I could defer till after the appellants, I would prefer that.
That actually would be, I think, up to the applicant, because usually that is the moment for rebuttal, and I don't want to interfere with that if they object. The applicant says that is not objectionable. So if I forget, somebody just needs to remind me. It is 2:50. Let's take a 5-minute recess and we will return and I will hear from the appellants.
Presentation from the appellants. Mr. Junior here and ready to go, and I am here and ready to hear you, sir. So if you come up and identify yourself, proceed.
I am Rod Crook. I live at 3855 West Main Street Road. It's just about where Mr. Wright's red line was. And I appreciate the opportunity to come to you. And I feel like I'm very inadequate. I've got a bunch of people here that have got far more education than I do. And I feel like a country pumpkin. I don't have all the terminology and everything else. But I do have one thing going for me. I've lived there for 30 years. I was a young man when I bought that piece of property. My father bought the piece of property that the dam sits on right now. I want to clarify that. He passed away in 98, and my mother passed away in 2001. The 25 acres across the east side of this dam, which is right side over there, 22 acres, he left to my brother and myself and my sister. And my brother and I sold, he left it all to us. We sold the west side, which the home sits on, the 2.5 acres across, to my sister and brother-in-law. So I want to make one thing, I want to clarify one thing. In the permit process, before I lose my train of thought and get on my PowerPoint here, the Department of Reclamation, I don't believe, has been notified.
Their jurisdiction in this is, it's FEMA, it's federal money. And why they were never notified, I don't know, but it's come to my attention that they weren't. What part they play in this, maybe they don't play any. But I'd like that clarified. And let's begin. I'm here to voice my concerns over the impact and effects on the removal of this dam and what it will be on the life of the species that call this home. Not only the fish, but all other sources, animals, birds, and the effect that it's going to have on human beings. I am and consider myself an environmentalist. I consider myself an ecologist. I consider myself a conservationist, to return the word. I love to hunt, I love to fish, and I care about the fish. I care about the animals. And I'm an American, which has given me the privilege to come before you. Heavens Creek Dam for 81 years. It was John Muir who said, when we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it hitched to everything else in the universe. This was the founder of the Sierra Club. This dam is hitched to many different issues. I was sent an agenda book from you, from this county, and here it is. It's all the papers I was sent. Thank you for that information. But what we were going to talk about today is all in this book and all over here. I read it carefully, and there's some things that I can test right off the bat. I can test page 14. Is this fill or dredge material a carrier of contaminants from on-site and off-site? The county answered it no. I believe they should have answered it yes. Section 3.1, page 20, is incomplete. The same section, page 32, 33, and 39, are wrong.
Can you be particular about those?
I can. They have to do with ownership of the dam, which you brought up. My sister and my brother-in-law do not own the dam.
And who are they by name?
Steve and Sharon Keaton, 3316 West Evans Creek Road. My father never owned that dam. Myron A. Croon, Jeanette D. Croon, bought the property in 1979. They were specifically told they didn't own that dam. That dam was under the control of Grants Pass Irrigation District and Jackson County Water Master. They were told not to ever touch the dam or the locks of the dam. I was in a meeting March the 6th, 2014. Mr. Hunter and Mr. Van Dyke were at that meeting, going through to the board of the Department of Fish and Wildlife, and they were seeking grant money. It's a 7-member board. Only 6 members were present. At that particular board, I made a presentation to that board. There was a lady by the name of Dixie Boley on that board. She was the only lady on that board. The vote at the end of the day was 3-3. It was a tie.
And this was a...
This was a grant money...
This was a request for grant money for this project?
I brought these claims to them at this board meeting. Dixie Boley, her conclusion to Mr. Hunter was, Mr. Hunter, let's back off on these dams. We've taken out the Savage Rapids Dam, we've taken out the Gold Hill Dam. We need to just back off and see what's going to happen because of the contaminants and everything else that are involved in these two dams. And she instructed Mr. Hunter, which he didn't want to have any instruction, and to me he didn't heed to this day, about, she wanted to know who really owned the dam the next time around.
Do you know who owns the dam?
I do know who owns the dam. In 1934, and I'm going to get into that in my PowerPoint.
We'll wait for that.
Wait for that.
Yeah, I don't have to jump ahead for you, sir.
Well, let's continue. Let's take a trip down Evans Creek. This is Alan Ayers and my son Todd. We put in May 31st, 2015, 16 days ago. We put in on my piece of property. My piece of property is right here. It goes across this creek. We're heading due north on the lake portion. This lake portion, Mr. Wright says, is about a mile long. It is. And we're heading towards the top. I want to get a view at the top. As you see to the left there of this slide, you see a sandy bar and kind of a slide area. As we were going by here, my son saw the beaver tuck his head back into those dens back in there. And you can see where he'd been laying on this slide here. That's about halfway between my place and a man that is here today, Rob Murphy. This is continuing on north. Okay, this is where that lake portion actually begins. This is at the very top. You can see the bird sitting on the rock there. That's where that is Evans Creek flowing into this wider section. This pretty much will be gone as a result of this.
And when you say gone, do you mean dewatered?
Yes, it will dry up. And in my next couple slides, I'll get there. We turned around it in this slide and headed back south towards the dam, back towards my place. Just to give you an idea, most people here that have never seen this up close, this is what it looks like. That's Fielder Mountain back there at the beginning. Looking south down Evans Creek from off Rod Murphy's place, way towards my home, in this area is pristine. The creek is beautiful. It's hosted many family pictures. I've been blessed to be living here for the past 38 years and enjoying this beautiful portion of the creek. I have stood my kid. This looks down from my house. I live up above the road. My property goes down and across. Anyway, I've seen herd of elk over the years standing in the middle of this creek. I've been blessed to see bald eagles. There's two bald eagles that nest in here. A man that is here today, Michael,
got your last name?
Rumston.
Rumston. He has a picture of those two bald eagles, and they're beautiful. You got a whole ecosystem unto its own here. You've got turtles. By the way, in here when we put in, we saw thousands, millions of little fingerling fish that are in here right now. And I didn't see one fish bloated in. This is where we put in that boat. I have seen, you said there's no record of floodplains in this area. This is a piece of land between the road and the creek that I own. I have seen water running as high as this truck park here, several times in the last 38 years. Just in 2004, I saw this covered with water. This is completely sandy silt in here. This is all sand. This is heading back down towards the dam about halfway. This was an old area that they called the potato patch. Dr. Clumhouse built my home in 1949. I have water rights here that date back to 1952. Not today in my possession, but it's the last meeting I went to when I bought those water rights, the originals. Anyway, this is a whole sandy bar up here. This is, they plant potatoes in there and just yield it great potatoes. They said I never planted anything in there. But this also has been covered with water during high rains. This comes up and it's quite wide. It's over 200 feet wide. We're back at the staging area. This is lot 204 that boat is pulled up on. In high water, just this last year, I saw the water 4 feet over the top of this dam. Those trees that you see hung up that Mr. Wright showed in his photo, they're the same trees. We, over the years, get down there and cut those out, usually in low in August, and pull those up off the dam because they catch right there. When this dam's not there, the water's still going to continue as the flows he described coming in and out. When those high water flows come down and this creek is really narrowed down, there's a log jam. You can see right at the bottom of this where these logs will hang up when that dam's not there. At least they hang up on the dam now. No way to remove them. This is all sandy loam. This is very soft. A lot of rock is going to have to be brought in here to stage. This is exactly where they're going to be coming down, staging their equipment in the creek. All of this is going to have to be tore up with a road made in there. This is lot 204 where they're going to stage. This is a 24-inch metal culvert going across West Evans Creek Road. This has been deemed an unbuildable lot by the county. My dad wanted to get permits to build on this and have another building site. He could not. All the water to the west of West Evans Creek Road and the west culvert of that road drains through this pipe. There's a lot of water. This is gushes with water during heavy rains. And it has eroded a big hole in the ground here. It had eroded lot 204. My dad put a concrete culvert pipe just below this one, which extends through this lot over to those bridge timbers. That's the timbers that they talk about in this report that they want removed. This concrete pipe goes directly through there. It's quite shallow. And it daylights about where those timbers are. And from there, it's quite eroded right down to the creek where the water drains.
So is that creek just to the left of those timbers?
Right in front. The erosion part?
No. Where is Evans Creek in relation to those?
Exactly right in front of us. The whole length of this picture up here, that's Evans Creek.
Okay.
Yeah. And we're looking to the east, directly to the east. This is Mr. Alan Ayer standing on the dam. You can see a better picture of that log jam out hanging up there. And that's what we do. We get down there with chainsaws, we cut those up. We actually get a big dozer on the other side with a big winch and steel cable and pull those back across to the place where you saw the rope part. And then we go ahead and finish cutting them up. We have to get out of there. What Alan Ayer is looking at and gazing at that down there is crawdads. It was full of crawdads down there, all the different kinds of crawdads, which to my knowledge were on endangered species. He's standing about 20 feet from the intake where the picture from. I turned around. This is the inlet to the first fish ladder. Again, it's May 31st, 16 days ago. This is the very top pool that inlet runs into. As I show you these slides of this fish ladder, I want you to know that these fish ladders were designed great, superbly. And you're going to be surprised who they were designed by. Got nice, easy flows of water there coming up over these fish ladders. All that is an algae growth. It's like a carpet. If you walk across there, it's not sharp rocks. It's like a carpet of grass on top of those ladders. That's another view of those ladders coming down there. Just very easy steps. That's about a 12-inch depth of fish have to come up. Deep pools, these pools are deep, they're running cold. I know because I actually spent. And we've got another picture of this superbly designed fish ladder. You can see the flows. There is no way that salmon have any, or any fish, have any hard time coming up these ladders right now. There are other spots south of this dam that the fish cannot maneuver right now. Natural areas that the fish can't get up. Didn't even make it to the ladders. This is very interesting. Let's take a look at this report. Activist profile by Bob Hunter. Water Watch members, Tom Simpson. Who's Tom Simpson? Well, he was the founder of Water Watch. That's who started Water Watch. Down about midway under those two pictures, that's a picture, I believe, of Tom in his younger years having his hand on the shovel, according to the article. And the fish ladders are right up in there, all getting ready to pour. He was responsible for those fish ladders. He was praised. Tom was a major force behind several fish habitat improvement projects, including the construction of a fish ladder to provide passage over Field Dam on Evans Creek, an important spawning tributary to the Rogue River. This was one of the largest and most significant habitat restoration project accomplishments by the Rogue Fly Fishers. Tom received the club's Dick Tough Award for outstanding conservation and an honorary lifetime membership. You know, I just have to scratch my head here. On one hand, they're praising this man's work. And on the other hand, they're saying it's inadequate now. They're saying it's not working, it's not functioning properly. The very man was their founder who designed this and helped build it. What's wrong with the ladder? What's wrong with the ladder is that very first step the fish have to come up. They say in low water times it's an inch out of step. So, and they say that the ladder is pointing the wrong direction, that the fish have a hard time finding it because, you know, it's not supposed to be pointing towards the face of the dam. It's supposed to be pointing to the south, pointing down the creek. Well, what's an alternative action here? It's been proposed more than once to just simply build another ladder and have the opening facing the south. There's plenty of room. You can see it in this picture. And fish can get up there. May 31st, fish can get up there. We're going to look at some other pictures here. This is the wall of that dam. I beg to differ with Mr. Wright's analysis. We're going to get into that in a minute. But from the footings of this dam here to the top of the dam, it's 22 feet. I have the copies of the original drawings. And behind this wall, there's another wall that you can't even see. It's below all the sediment. This wall, this dam was very well engineered. This is looking west. You can see up there the little jog in the top. That's where the channel for the irrigation is. You're looking at a document that is from 1934. Those words on this piece of paper, not this piece of paper, it's a copy, but on the original one I took the copy from, that's 1934 writing. Preliminary designs and computations for Evans. And notice something. They never referred to this as Field or Creek Dam. From the beginning, it was always referred to as Evans Creek Dam. There was a Field or Creek Dam, and its longitude and latitudes are different than Evans Creek, if you really examine the records. And that dam wasn't built behind this dam. That dam was built in front of this dam. And I have information about that as well. 1934, E.L. Rydell was the designer. Here's pictures, actual pictures, of the construction of the dam and how they made their bypasses. And it's just very interesting. The steel, the reinforcing steel in this dam in 1934, 3,400 feet of steel is in this dam face. This is one of Rydell's original drawings It's just one of many. You can see how he's designed this and all the calculations below. You really can't see them from here. They're hard to make out. There was no computers back in 1934. There were slide rules. These guys were sharp. All these computations were made. The top computation, as you see, that's a floodplain line. It says up, if you can move up there, flood flows. It was designed to take a flood flow 7.5 feet above the top of the dam. You can see the 22 feet over here, and you can see the 29.5 feet from the top of the dam to the very base of that dam. That's a lot different than 15 feet.
Where's the 15 foot number come from?
It came from Mr. Wright.
I think his 15 foot number was the depth of sediment behind the dam, not the dam height.
Well, I think it figured different because of that, because of the see the way the footings are in the dam. There's a double wall here. You see the front wall? You see the back wall? Well, right there at the line, that was sediment that came down in there. So yeah, for 15 feet from that point, but look what's down underneath the dam. There's quite a bit of, and they had to backfill that. What's all in there, I guess we'll all be surprised. Who owns the dam? We're going to come back to this subject. 1934, the old mill and ditch irrigation company is listed in the archives as the owner. The old ditch and mill irrigation company was dissolved in 1987. The registry on that registration that was dissolved in 1987 was a Mary Graves. It linked the address to 2011 West Evans Creek Road. Way before this date, that dam was turned over to Grants Pass Irrigation District. And that's who ran the dam all the time. My dad owned the property, which was starting in 1979. Never did the old ditch and mill company own the land under the dam. From 1987 to 2002, who was the owner of the dam? It was abandoned in the late 80s when Grants Pass Irrigation District, the address that they put their large electric pump in to supply the ditches above West Evans Creek is 1300. 1300 block, they sunk a big water pump. And they put a line under West Evans Creek Road, an 8-inch line, that comes up the bank and then supplies the irrigation. Yes, they were the ones that abandoned the dam. But mysteriously, Steve and Sharon Keaton became owners of Evans Creek Dam after 2002. How they did that was Jackson County, and how that was done, I'm going to explain it. Jackson County decided they were going to collect some money for some inspection reports. So, well, they sent a bill to my brother Steve, and my brother-in-law Steve, and my sister Sharon Keaton. And instead of disputing that bill and getting a big hassle about it, they just paid it.
What was the bill for?
It was for inspections. You know, just inspections on the dam. And to keep up with the inspections. The last inspection, I think, was 2010. Was the last inspection. The money trail. 1934, the old ditch and mill company was funded by the Civil Works Administration, CWA. That was just prior to Franklin Eleanor Roosevelt's New Deal. That all became part of it in the 30s. People were scrambling for work. They didn't have any money. They put them to work on building this dam. Federal. The man that headed this CWA in Medford, Oregon, his name was Frank Hull, H-U-L-L. In 1934, also in the archives, in the records, the Oregon State Emergency Relief Fund, the SERA, they were involved in getting donations and supplying money for this project. To my knowledge, the old mill and ditch company never had one penny in it. In 1981, the Rogue Fly Fishers founder, Tom Simpson, of Water Watch, went out there where he got his money from to put those fish ladders in through the Rogue Fly Fishers. I don't know. They were grants. That information I could not come across, and I'm trying diligently to get it. But I know that Mr. Simpson has labor involved in it. He had a stake in those fish ladders and in the dam. In 1915, well, we just got a report from this nice young lady.
You mean 2015?
2015. We just got a nice report from this young lady who's supplying the money to take it out. So I know in 2009, Jackson County had an issue with the Gold Bray Dam, and it was abandoned by the power company. And Jackson County ended up taking responsibility for the Gold Bray Dam. And NOAA gave them a grant of $5 million to take that dam out. That's a matter of public record. Steve and Sharon Keaton, they've never put $0 into this dam.
So I understand this, but what I don't understand, help me here, please, Mr. Kroom, is...
Yes.
First of all, what is the relevance of the ownership of the dam? That's a question. Let me ask two questions, please. Second question is, what is the relevance of whether your sister and brother-in-law have contributed any money to the removal of the dam?
Okay, I will. It's been insisted that, even right here in this meeting already, that Steve and Sharon Keaton own this dam. They do not. They have no financial stakes in this dam.
Who owns the dam?
I believe, from what I've studied, that Jackson County is responsible for this dam.
You're saying Jackson County owns the dam?
I'm saying Jackson County owns the dam. Only because of the precedent that they set on the Gold Bray Dam. And they did set a precedent there by accepting responsibility for the Gold Bray Dam. But that happened not to sit on private land.
What are the indications or the facts that support the statement that Jackson County accepted responsibility for the dam?
For Gold Bray Dam?
No, this dam.
Oh, they've never accepted any responsibility for this dam.
Okay, help me understand. I thought you said that the fact that they accepted responsibility for Gold Bray Dam, established their ownership of Gold Bray Dam. I thought you're drawing a parallel here. So what are the facts that establish that Jackson County owns the dam? Question number one. Number two, what's the relevance of that with respect to the application? And I'm not saying there's none. And third, what is the relevance of whether Mr. and Mrs. Keaton have contributed to the removal of the dam?
To address your first point, the only correlation that I have in Jackson County is their control over the dam through the water master. That's the only correlation that I have. They were in control of what went on that dam.
Okay.
Your second point, could you refresh my memory?
Yeah, I can, I think. Is what is the relevance of who owns the dam at all?
Oh,
does it matter that Mr.
Yes.
and Mrs. Keaton don't own the dam?
Oh, yes. There's a lot of relevance. And I'm going to get to that point in my PowerPoint. You want me to explain it to you?
I would like you to explain it to me now because it's
liability.
Very present.
It's liability. That's the bottom issue. My sister and brother-in-law have been told repeatedly by Water Watch that they're not going to have any liabilities in this at all. Until this very last meeting at OWEP. And in that meeting, Mr. John DeVoe was there. He's the attorney for Water Watch in Portland. And in the minutes of those meetings, if you were to pull the minutes of those meetings, he was asked point blank, that was a board of 13 people, I was there. They didn't want to listen to me at all. Their minds were made up, it's going this way. They're signed on to this. You know what this is. It's from River Design, it's all the whole design of this dam. They're signed on to it. American Rivers is signed on to it. Geos is signed on to it. EcoTrust, all these people.
What's the relevance?
It's liability. They said in that meeting, John DeVoe did, because he was asked point blank, are the property owners going to be liable in any way? His answer was yes. That's all it was. So that's my point about who takes responsibility for the dam. That's my point. And who lost their wells in Gold Ray? Who paid for the wells that were lost, the two wells that were lost in Gold Ray? I'm upstream. I have seen the creek, you saw where we launched the boat, completely dry. I could walk across it and not get my feet wet. That's because of the gravel and everything else in there, the water goes underground.
So if I understand you reading between the lines, Mr. Kroom, that one of the aspects of liability that you're concerned about is whether Mr. and Mrs. Keaton, as owners of the dam, would be liable if wells were lost because of the removal of the dam and
exactly.
The lake. And the last question was the relevance of whether Mr. and Mrs. Keaton, of the fact that Mr. and Mrs. Keaton have contributed no money to the removal of the dam.
That's correct.
And the relevance of that is that basically you're trying to separate them from liability?
Well, yeah, I'm gonna answer that broadly. My sister and brother-in-law, myself and my brother, were sued by Water Watch because we didn't want the dam to be removed. And here's how we got it in the lawsuit. I have copies. You can go online and get a copy of the lawsuit.
I don't think I need them.
If we don't cooperate with them, that's the bottom line, and let them take this dam out, that we are going to be responsible for footing the bill to take this dam out ourselves. Because one way or the other, the dam's coming out. Now, if we get along with them and let them do their thing, hey, it's not going to be any of cost to us at all. Me, I said, no, I want to fight. My brother said, yeah, you know, he doesn't live there. He lives in Grants Pass. He was neutral. I lived there. My sister and my brother-in-law, oh, man, she's a nervous wreck. She said, I don't have any money for a lawsuit. I can't fight this thing. I mean, we're talking about going clear back to Noah. You know, how are we going to fight Noah? We're just little people here. You know, I just want to get it over. They're going to take it out. I just want it done. I just got to get through this, you know. She's upset. She begged my brother and myself to sign off on the 25 or 20 acres across that creek and let her and her husband handle this. And she was coerced into doing that. If they were here to talk to you and explain to it that Mr. Hunter wanted to work with one party, he didn't want to work with three parties. So let this happen. Just get your brothers off of this thing and we'll work with you and we'll make this thing happen. That is the truth of the story. And right now, to this present day, if they were to stand up here and you were to ask them, Mr. and Mrs. Keaton, you want this dam gone?
They would say, no, sir.
Why are they not here to protest?
They're not here to protest because of fear.
Of me?
Not of you. Of the lawsuit they still have pending on them. This was a direct question in the last OWEP meeting. The prior one...
Has that lawsuit been resolved? Is there a final determination of that lawsuit?
They explained.
They being?
Water Watch and the attorneys for Water Watch. That this is in a stay. The lawsuit's in a stay. They explained what a stay was, John DeVoe did, in that meeting. He said it's just a deep sleep. That's what a stay is. It's just a deep sleep. It's a deep sleep that, just like that, you can wake up from.
So if I can put words in your mouth, and correct me if I don't put accurate words in your mouth, the Mr. and Mrs. Keaton, as you report it, are cooperating because if they do not, then this lawsuit is going to come back to life.
That is correct.
And what is their jeopardy under the lawsuit?
That they will be...
They'll have to pay to have the dam taken out?
All the expenses.
And what's the regulatory or other authority that would require them to do that?
No.
The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration.
Exactly.
I don't know what I can do about NOAA, Mr. Kerm.
Yeah, they're pretty big, aren't they? That's big government just having its thumb on us. I'd like a phone number. You know, it'd be nice to have a phone number. Who to call if my well was dry?
Continue, sir, please. I just want to bring to your attention now, it's 20 minutes to 4. And I want to be sure there's adequate time left for the many people who have signed up as wanting to speak. So I don't know where you are in your presentation, but please be respectful of time for other people as well.
Yeah, well, I noticed that River Design here with a lot of time.
I'm not telling you to stop, sir.
Okay. Toxins released from sediments. That is a very big concern. It's been a big enough concern that an organization that signed on to this writes these words. Dam removal does result in changing to the local environment. The reservoir will be eliminated and its flat water habitat that had been created will also most likely be eliminated. Wetlands surrounding the reservoir may also be drained. Although new wetlands may be created, both in the newly restored river, reaches above the former dam site, and in the river below. Sediments that are collected behind the dam, sometimes over hundreds of years, may contain toxins such as PVCs, dioxide, heavy metals. Removal of these toxin materials is often extremely expensive. And the threat of resuspending these toxins-laden sediments in the process of dam removal has a potential to damage upstream and downstream fish and wildlife and users of the water.
Can you identify who is making this assessment? And
yes.
Was the assessment made specifically with respect to this dam?
American Rivers. I'm reading a quote from American Rivers. On an article they wrote called Frequent Asked Questions. And they are addressing the question, what are the potential downsides of dam removal? You can get this information off of AmericanRivers.org. May I continue?
Please.
These impacts, however, prevent for proper removal techniques, short-term impacts of the dam removal itself can include increased water turbidity and sediments build up downstream from large releases of amounts of sediment from the reservoir. And the water quality impacts are sudden when they are released. And temperature changes. It has been demonstrated that these are short-term impacts and greatly outweigh the quick recovery time of the system and long-term benefit results. My point is there's 81 years of toxic chemicals behind this dam.
So let me stop you there, sir. And I don't know whether there are or are not toxic chemicals behind this dam, but that article that you just quoted didn't conclude that there are. It said there may be.
Sure.
Do we know? And if so, without diminishing your concern, is there anything in the criteria that I can assess this application by that addresses that issue?
Yes.
First of all, do we know? And secondly,
yes. Allen Ayers has that information. They took what they call just a grab scoop of gravel. They didn't even have any. They admit in their findings that none of this was fine material. They admit that they couldn't get through the hard pan to get down and take an adequate core, really. They just scooped it off the bottom of the creek. Allen Ayers went out there over a year ago and got his core down 2 feet. And he pulled over a pound of material up in that core and sent it off to an accredited laboratory, Reed Laboratories in Carlsbad, California. Their findings are different than the findings they just got here a few months back.
Are you going to provide those to me? But I have to
yes.
tell you, I still don't know where in the criteria that I have to use to assess this application and your appeal it mentions toxic materials. It's a public health issue if it's there, but I do not believe that in the criteria within the land development ordinance, and particularly those that are applicable here, I have any jurisdiction over toxic chemicals or materials. That's another agency's issue.
But you do, I mean, it's been brought up as far as the health of not only the species involved, but the human beings as well. Does that fall under your jurisdiction?
If there's a sufficient connection, it may. If there is a sufficient connection. But the connection has to be made that the materials are there, what the materials are, and what the connection between that and those health aspects that I may have jurisdiction over, how they would be affected.
So the county really, what you're saying is the county doesn't really have any determination in what if there is toxic chemicals there, what to do about it. They just go ahead and permit the...
The county's jurisdiction is limited to aspects of how the dam removal will affect various aspects of the floodplain itself.
Okay, well, let me continue.
Mm-hmm.
This is a canyon. This is looking right directly at the pool from the bottom of the dam to the pool the dam empties into. And it goes to this very first falls right here. This is extremely narrow. There's rock on both sides that have been there for centuries. That's only about 10 feet wide. Those falls are more treacherous to the salmon than right on top of it, there's two sets of falls. This is the upper fall, and then you can see the lower fall on the picture. This is a natural wash through the rock over centuries. The river's been flowing down there. A lot of fish in the high water, in the higher water, come up this in the springtime because it's filled with water. And they avoid half the fish ladders altogether. This dumps into the midway up the fish ladders. My son there is standing in the middle of that water, hollowed out rock. You can see that's a good picture of the falls. That's the second falls. Fish have a lot harder time coming up those falls right now than any one of those fish ladders. That's more of an impediment for the fish the fish ladders themselves. There's another picture of that. I mean, that's a lot of struggle for any sizable fish to get up. May the 31st, 16 days ago. This house, how does it play into it? Well, we'll get there in a minute. We'll talk about a little bit about erosion. This is a mile, just a little bit more than a mile south of the dam. This used to have somewhat of a backyard. This house has been for sale for over 7 years. It hasn't sold. I wonder why. The footings of this here are sitting right on top of the edge of the creek. This deck overhangs the back. That's all eroded in high winter waters. The dam, the Evans Creek runs primarily to the west side, all the way down. That's the sand and gravel bar. That's what my property up there in that lake area is going to look like, most likely. That's a very narrow, narrow sandbar, gravel bar right down there. And this is, again, 2,100 watts. That's, I was on the deck, I turned around and took a picture south towards the Little River. And see how rocky it is in this section here? Very, very hard for any sizable fish, and how long it is here. Any sizable fish to get up there to the ladders right now. There's much more problems on this creek than the ladders. This is the erosion down at the 300 block of West Evans Creek Road. You see up here a building? That is the church building. This creek takes a sharp, hard western turn here. Water in the wintertime will run up this high. All that sandbar that you just saw in that last slide will be completely covered. This is standing in the church property. You see how they got this orange safety net here? That is the edge of the bank right now. You can take this fence and bring it over here and lay it down and touch the church. Erosion is a big problem. That is right underneath that orange fencing. The creek here is about 8 feet wide. You can see how shallow it runs now. It's going to run a lot more. It's already 16 days later, I guarantee you, run a lot less than it is there. You see the debris, the logs that get down here in heavy water. And they, this is just all really shallow ripples in here. This again is just below that church. This is looking back at that logs you just saw. Here they are. They've walked more south towards the mouth. Here's the footbridge going over Palmington Park. The Little River. This is all gravel. This is all covered with water and heavy rains. But they subside quick. This is a bridge on Foothill. Right there where that bench is, I took my next shot, and it's this. The creek, this is the creek. It's about 10 feet across. It's about no more than 6 inches deep right now. And for quite a distance, probably 25 feet. When we try to pick out anything by itself, we find it's hitched to everything else in the first time there. I stood on the south side of that bridge. This is a picture to the mouth of this creek dumping into the Little River. This area here is about 10 yards wide. It's about 10 yards long. It's not even 2 inches deep. It's a gravel bar. Fish, any sizable fish, coming out of the river within 100 yards here cannot make it up this ground. It's impossible, let alone ever trying to reach the ladder. There's a lot of issues on the river for fish, and it's just not a fish ladder. I thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Are you going to be providing any copies of your PowerPoint for the record? Okay, if you give them to Mrs. Harris. Thank you very much for your thoughtful and thorough presentation, sir.
Yeah. Alan Ayer is here to speak for me on behalf of the toxins.
Well, we're taking, let's see, we have to conclude at 4:30.
And I have a professor on wildlife from the Institute, John Minkey.
Would you ask them how much time they need in their most efficient, please?
How much time do you need?
3 minutes is enough.
And Mr. Ayer?
3 to 5.
Can you hold it? 3.
I'll try faster.
So, well, Mr. Ayer, you are first on the list, so may I hear from you? I'm going to set the timer at 3 minutes and hope we make it. Let me start this here. And if you'd state your name, please. And
my name is Alan Ayer, EHR from Grants Pass, Oregon. My family's been here for over 80 years. I'd like to submit this one document to you in the question about public health. And this was something that I have done and followed through. I've been on the other two dams when they were taken out also. It's my main concern is the Fielder Dam. I'd like to
go ahead.
Give you a copy of this. I'm sorry I didn't have more than one, but it's pretty self-explanatory.
Okay.
That same document over the last, sent on Friday, was requested by the Corps of Engineers for me. Part of this document was also given at the Water Board meeting. They were there trying to get the grant money, their $400,000+. When I was first there and we got into the meeting for 2 days, listened to the people speak about different projects, and they got to this one, and they asked, and people got to come forward and speak, Rod and myself, and then people from Water Watch. What my concern was, the board, made up of 9 people, at the Water Enhancement Board, stated, and it's something was said to me in the beginning by one of the people, Eric, that's with the board. When people go to vote, if 3 people, it takes 3 people to vote it down to stop the project, no matter what project it is. Anything after that is kind of a no-brainer, I guess, what people would say. My biggest concern is that in this process, the board, after giving every one of them a copy of this, and Water Watch had a copies of it, but they did not, for some reason, turn it over to the Corps of Engineers in requesting the permits, which would go through NEPA, and an environmental impact statement, which has not been seen yet. This project cannot go forward without one of those, period. My conversation with the legal department of the Corps of Engineers as of Friday, which that the name is on that paper and her fax number, where she asked me to send it to. So, and my biggest part of this, when you talk about this,
I'm going to interrupt you for a second, Mr. Ayer, because you're 2 minutes into your time, and I haven't heard anything yet that I know you really want me to hear. So let me ask you to get back into the details.
In this
please.
Document, you're going to find out there's 5 pages in there about a mine system that's upstream of this and the other dams. That particular mine has been used back in the 50s and further, and actually the window of time in 1902, the engineering department of the state of Oregon was founded. 1909 is when they actually started the projects to put a dam in. My concern was, from that window of time, these toxins have been coming down from the two creeks, from Evans Creek, into Evans comes Mill Hollow Creek, which is on the mine site. Mine site's covered with tailings, 32,000 pounds of mercury sulfide cinnabar. Tailings are all over this site, covered with arsenic, 8 times the level allowed legally, even under EPA guidelines. This is all being handled by DEQ and EPA. It's an illegal mine site, it's an illegal depository as we speak right now that nobody's bothered to tell anybody that's just upstream from this dam. My biggest reason for explaining this to you is that the toxins on that site since the early 30s and 20s may be behind this dam. My samples, by the way, 8 at the wall of the dam on the rim, 4 to 6 feet, 8 of them. Back upstream a quarter mile, 2 more, 4 to 6, 8 feet. Those findings are in this document that I have and will show you. This was my reason for concern of saying this is a health risk. Number one, the health advisory a year ago put out by Jackson County is we're concerned with the health advisory on the Rogue River for mercury's in it. Oh, we think it was about miners panning gold, and it wasn't. This was a product of something that happened that was done 100 years ago that's behind this dam that we need to be worried about a health advisory. And the two points of this is, I proved not only behind Gold Gray when they took it out, we had other issues. I'm the one, that person between Jackson and Josephine County that founded the hexavalent chromium here that is a carcinogen causing cancer.
I'm going to give you one more minute, sir. That will be fully five that you asked for. Okay. Go ahead.
And I apologize. In this, one other part of this under the environmental impact statement is the Corps of Engineers looks at whether or not there's a substantial financial burden on any other entity. The city of Grants Pass, over and above what they normally spend, it's almost $250,000 in the last 3 years, just for extra sampling that they were concerned with the hexavalent chromium that came from behind Gold Ray Dam. So that was not successful. That was not something that wasn't...
Did they find any?
Yes. They actually found it here.
And what was the level?
The level here, okay.
What was the level that Grants Pass found downstream of the after the removal of Gold Ray Dam?
After the removal between Gold Ray and Savage Rapids, when those were taken out, we hit numbers as high as 1.189. Now, chromium can't be 0.1. This was 1.189. Our number averaged here in Jackson County, which they only put in one news advisory or advisory that went in the newspaper on page 3 pages. It was this big in the paper. All they said, well, our hexavalent chromium.
Yeah, let's have the number. Wait.
The number is 0.198 just for Jackson County. Now, they knew it. Water Department knew it. They did nothing about it, nor did they try to. That's a health advisory. It's an issue. But yet, a year ago, they say health advisory over all of the road for mercury. Mercury that causes cancer, the issues that we have, the highest levels, second highest levels in the nation here of cancer relative to these issues. That's my point of all of this. Because of the health advisory, this was brought to my attention because of the Corps of Engineers and the document that they sent me and that they requested from me on Friday. They're highly concerned. Three of the documents haven't been turned into the Corps of Engineers for them to approve this, nor has NEPA at the time even been started. That was at 4 in the afternoon, sir.
Thank you, sir. And the wildlife individual you talked about, Mr. Kroom, what is his name, sir?
John Binkey.
I'm actually not a wildlifer, although I do a lot of research in that area. I was a professor in the School of Forestry and Conservation at Berkeley for 5 years and the Department of Agronomy and Range Science at Davis for 20.
So would you do me a favor, sir, first? I'm struggling to find your name on this list. I imagine it's on John Menke, M-E-N-K-E, and your address, sir.
I live down in Scott Valley.
Fort Jones?
Fort Jones, yeah. I've been fully involved in the dam removal efforts by the Department of Interior and others on the Klamath River. And I'm now a professional friend with Dr. Paul Hauser, who was a whistleblower on removal of that dam, when in fact he discovered that Salazar just won that dam out, regardless of what the expert panel has said.
I just want to advise you the same thing I advised Mr. Ayer, which is 3 minutes.
I'm
going to 3 minutes.
Yeah. So I must talk specifically on coho salmon. What I'm saying is the promoters of this dam removal are the same kind of promoters that want the Klamath River dams out, because it's part of Agenda 21. And I didn't know that until about 6 months ago, but it's actually in the original document. Number one, this dam, actually the pool above the dam, provides a beaver dam-like habitat for coho salmon juveniles. I should tell you, I happen to have bought a ranch in Quartz Valley that has 500 acre-feet of storage in the Marble Mountain Wilderness area. In 2010, we produced 200,000 coho fingerlings, and the world's expert on coho, Larry Lestelle, came all the way from Puget Sound to see our rearing habitat.
Mr. Henke, I'm trying to protect your opportunity to provide testimony. You need to restrict yourself to this matter.
Okay. Well, the matter is, coho juveniles cannot hold in fast water. The dam actually provides a beaver dam, slow water type of habitat that it fosters their reproduction. That's the only listed species we've got here, beef involved, as far as I understand it. So that's a real benefit. The other item I just wanted to mention briefly, the engineer that spoke earlier, incidentally, I taught dynamic simulation modeling at both Berkeley and Davis. He pointed out health was the number one issue when he started out. Then he proceeded to show where he had done other sites, none of which were in Southern Oregon, where we have an incredible heavy metal concentration. So I have seen the data and looked it over thoroughly. We've got a real mercury, we got a real arsenic, we got a real chromium, maybe a lot of hexavalent chromium. This sorting of the water dynamics on the top of the sediments behind this dam are such that nobody has sampled deep enough to really know what the concentrations are. So I would suspect, and here's my most blatant statement, I suspect that Jackson County could potentially be liable by the people of Grants Pass for their death rate and in the future. Hexavalent chromium is a slow killer, and this could be a hell of a mess down the road. So I think you better find out what's behind down deeper before you take it out and see whether that has to be removed separately in a much more careful process rather than have it show up at the Grants Pass water supply like what happened after. That's really all I have to say.
Thank you very much, sir. All right, so let me proceed here. We are down to about 25 minutes and probably a little less because we have some procedural things. And plus, are you going to rebut here or are you going to rebut in writing?
Here.
Here. And how much time do you want me to reserve for you for rebuttal?
I would say 10 to 15 is probably enough if that's, we can keep it short.
Are you going to rebut in writing as well?
At this point,
show five individuals who want to speak against the application, of whom I think we do have enough time here. I think we can proceed with the people who are here who want to speak against the application having 3 minutes apiece for. To make sure I'm right, with those of you who want to speak against the application who haven't spoken yet, just raise your hand so I can get a head count. I've got three. Okay, that's fine. So I'm still going to allow the 3 minutes of testimony. I believe we will make it through. And the first person on the list who has indicated they want to speak against the application is Michael Rustrum. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for your patience.
Good afternoon. My name is Michael Rustrum. I live at 3254 West Evans Creek Road, City of Gold River, Oregon.
Okay, and I'm starting your time, sir.
Okay. Part of the issue with the garden comes to the attention of this panel is who owns the dam? And I partially own the dam. That is the reality. The dam does sit on my property on the west bank. I have an abutment.
Do you happen to know your tax parcel number?
Yes, I do.
Please, if you would.
My tax parcel numbers are 500, 600, and 700.
All right, I'll find them. And you are in the west abutment of this dam?
That's correct.
Okay, go ahead. I see them.
And I believe the folks from Water Watch et al. Were well aware of this fact, which is why their plans, they aren't indeed leaving a portion of the dam. I don't believe they've done any sort of survey on my property to tell me where my property line is and how they can ascertain where it is. I do have information to present to the court regarding a survey I had done in 1992, which showed my property actually extended 12 feet further than what the current county is listing. On all of their mapping, they present through the lines that they say are approximate lines for this issue. I don't think you can approximately take someone's property. And that puts this comes down to it as well. And if I may, one other issue I'd like to raise is that there was a state, SHPO, State Historical Preservation.
SHPO, yeah. Let me interrupt you a second. I'll stop your time. Are you going to provide me more information about this ownership issue you're raising? You going to submit something for me to look at?
I do have that, Your Honor.
Okay. Go ahead then.
Yeah, please do. Proceedings.
Go ahead.
The other issue that I think is very relevant to these proceedings is the fact that the historic preservation specialist who studied this dam fully, and I'm hopeful that you're in receipt of that. If not, I'd be happy to provide that in its entirety. And what it clearly delineates is that the dam is of historical importance, so much so that it was deemed to be eligible for the National Register of Historic Places.
Did it get listed?
Yes, it did. And most certainly did. And rightfully so, and under two criteria, Criteria A was for the historical significance to the folks who live in Evansville. And you'll see that significance as you read through this report. And for Criteria C, the specialized construction of a dam. It's a very unique dam. One of the reasons it has stood the test of time is it is a very well designed dam, actually designed by an engineering graduate from the one of our universities right here in Washington.
I do not have that report. If you want me to regard it, you need to submit it. But again, it is subject to my determination that I have any criteria that it relates to. But if you want me to have the opportunity to look at it, if I find that it does, it should be in the record.
Okay. I do believe it relates, and I have information on that, to the overall broad spectrum of the comprehensive plan itself.
The county's comprehensive plan?
Right. I'm planning to go five.
Okay, so I would urge you to make sure that that's before me. Actually, would you take a moment and discuss that with me right now? How it relates to the comp plan?
If I could just present. Further approach, I have a brief letter that pretty much states my position.
Actually, why don't you hand that to Mrs. Harris, because that's the best way for it to get into my hands. And I'm going to hand this over to Mrs. Harris as well. And you're telling me it's the highlighted areas within this excerpt from the Goal 5 resource document for Jackson County.
And once again, the letter itself will define and make that clear.
Okay. All right, sir. Well, thank you very much. substantive, I will certainly rule about whether I do have jurisdiction over it or not. Thank you. Rick Barkley, please.
My name is Rick Barkley from Applegate, Oregon. I'm the president of the Police Mining District, which encompasses Josephine, Jackson, and Douglas counties. Specifically, there's a potential violation that the county should be aware of because they can become liable for this. It was Section 7.2.1c about public health. We've discussed morphology, we've discussed the hydrology, we have discussed geology. The upper Evans Creek Road area is the most productive mineral, mercury mineral zone in southwest Oregon. That's from the Department of Geology and Mineral Industries handbook. So the issue behind the removal of the dams had a great EPA, not EPA, but the Oregon DEQ sediment evaluations. There was no checking for heavy metals. They checked for aromatic hydrocarbons, which means they look for gas and oil. So you have a potential liability of incredibly large amount of mercury behind those dams. And I will say to you and to anyone else who's involved in the dam removal that you're opening yourself up to potential third-party Clean Water Act suits, which are now legal. So I would look very carefully into the sedimentation and the health issues, because you're going to discharge that immediately downriver to both the Rogue River public water source and the Grants Pass public water treatment source. So it's not just a matter of we're going to save some fishies, okay? People are important too, and you're going to potentially contaminate large amounts of drinking water. The DEQ is talking about listing the entire road drainage as a 303D impaired waterway because of mercury. At the behest of many of these fine people here, I find it somewhat remiss that they would plan to feed a large contributing source of mercury and arsenic and the hexavalent chromium based on the geology of the landscape. It's a fact of the landscape. There's no escaping. No remediate. The country produces mercury, but if those dams are impounding it because of the nature of mercury being heavy, it sets. If you release those sediments and stir up all that mercury and all those other chemicals, they're going to go down the stream and they're going to continue to flush and become the methyl mercury that they so widely dread by the disturbance of the mercury. So it's imperative that that be considered in this narrative. Potential for incredibly large ecological disaster from the release of those. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good timing, I would say. Nice work. So I believe I have got everyone who indicated they wanted to speak against the application.
I was the last on the list there, Your Honor.
Oh, then please come forward, sir. Rob Murphy.
My name is Rob Murphy. I live at 4244 West Evans Creek Road, just on the up end of the impoundment there. And I've lived there for 8 or 9 years. My concern here is actually with the fish, or for the fish, because as Mr. Prune hinted at or touched on, is that the impoundment is actually home to a lot of fish. I was there on there yesterday with my canoe, went down from the upper end down the mile to the base of the dam. And you can see that it is loaded with fish fry. Obviously, there's no way to know. I would say several hundred thousand is not out of the question there. What my concern is that there are, you know, and I'm not a hydrologist, I'm not an engineer, I'm not an attorney, but I have had college education and a little bit of trigonometry, so I did a rough calculation of the sediment behind the dam, and from the face of the dam, it's obviously wider there than it is at the upper end of the impoundment, but the gravel in the impoundment extends back up from, say, you know, 15 feet, I think is what you were saying, but I kind of think it might be more than that, all the way back up the mile where it tapers up to where the natural level of the creek is. But my calculations is there's at least a quarter of a million cubic yards of gravel and sand in there. Probably more like, could be half a million. I could be wrong, but it's a lot of gravel. And so knowing that in August and September, the water flows in Evans Creek just dropped to next to nothing. I talked to Travis, the water master in Jackson County, who said, I was really upset because in every year people take so much water out of from the creek that I have a section of the creek up at the top end where it's just solid bedrock.
You're at a minute.
And so it's down to probably 20 cubic feet a minute at the, you know, in September. So when the dam is, if it's removed, that 20 cubic feet a minute will just percolate through this gravel, unless there's a provision made for the gravel to somehow make a channel that mile for fish passage during that time. I'm not even sure that one winter of flooding would be enough to remove that much gravel. So I'm thinking I am concerned about the fish if it is taken out. So I hope that there's a provision made for that and that something can be done so that a lot of fish are not killed by the removal of this dam.
Thank you very much.
And, yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Then I
got to
run.
Okay. I won't hold you back, don't worry. Mr. Ross, still here? Steve Ross did not wait to make a statement that was neutral on the project. All right. So it is now the applicant's opportunity for rebuttal. And I don't want to constrain your time for rebuttal. I just asked that you be efficient. I want you to have the opportunity to rebut. So if it goes beyond 4:30, I would ask the county to indulge us in that. But before you proceed, Kelly Manning, the county's director of development services, wants to respond to the ownership issue, at least with respect to the assertion that the county owns the dam.
Thank you, Mr. Hearings Officer. My name is Kelly Manning. I'm the Jackson County Development Services Director here at 10 South Oakdale. And I just wanted to address two points that the appellant made as they relate to sort of the assertion that Jackson County owns this dam, Fielder Dam. And he compared it to our ownership of Gold Ray Dam. There are some significant differences. The county owned Gold Ray Dam. It owned the 26 acres that the powerhouse, the fish ladders, the dam, and the counting station all sort of resided on. So in fact, we did own Gold Ray Dam. We do not own, Jackson County does not own Fielder Dam. It is not comparable in any way. And I guess I wanted to also address, there was an assertion that because Jackson County, via the Water Master, which is a state of Oregon position, not a Jackson County position, the Water Master is not under the authority of Jackson County, although the Water Master does sit in our building at 10 South Oakdale. The state Water Resources Department is actually the body that houses or that employs the Water Master. That there was some connection because the Water Master did some inspections of the dam and had somehow connected Jackson County to that. I would say that, again, Jackson County does not employ the Water Master, nor, frankly, even if we did, an inspection does not equal ownership. If that were the case, Jackson County would own almost every house in Jackson County, as we've inspected pretty much everyone, every house that exists here. So I just wanted to address those two issues to make it clear and be on, and be on the record that Jackson County does not own Fielder Dam. And it could not be compared to our ownership of Gold Ray Dam, because we in fact did own Gold Ray Dam. So thank you, Mr. Hearings Officer, for indulging me.
Ms. Fagan.
So I just want to start by pointing out that neither the appellant nor any of the opponents have specifically pointed to any of the criteria in the LDO that they believe has not been met by this application, or any additional criteria which they believe apply to this application. With respect to the issues that were raised, the ownership issue, the Keatons have entered into an agreement that allows the applications for this project to be submitted. There are documents in the record that show that they in fact own the property that the dam is on. A title search shows that there are no other ownership rights in the dam. The agreement that the Keatons entered into is not at issue in this proceeding. The Keatons have not come before this hearings officer to somehow revoke their agreement to allow this application to go forward, nor is there any claim that they have entered into that agreement under any form of duress. So I don't see how that is an issue that could be raised here.
Does, and I don't know if I have jurisdiction over it in any case, does that agreement in any regard address the ownership issue?
The ownership issue was addressed through conveyances from the trust to the Keatons, and that documentation is included in the record, and the agreement that was entered into shows that the Keatons have the right to enter into that agreement and allow these applications to move forward.
And you characterize the agreement as having two critical elements, and maybe more. One was they agreed to the to the application, and there's
operating the process of applications.
Yeah. Was there another critical element in that agreement? I don't recall having seen that agreement.
I'm
submitting
that.
You're submitting it.
As for the portion of the dam that Mr. Rustrom says is on his property, that portion of the dam is not going to be removed as part of this project and is not a necessary component of this project. None of the work that's going to be done as part of the project will go on to that property. With respect to the Bureau of Reclamation being notified, there are no permits required from the Bureau of Reclamation. They do not have any regulatory authority over this dam or any structure or any oversight of the structure. With respect to well loss, wells that may be impacted upstream of the dam, there was a search of all existing well logs that was done, and each of those wells are over 70 feet and were determined to not, will not be impacted by the dam removal project. With respect to the various issues regarding sediment that were raised, those issues are not relevant to the floodplain development permit application. Those issues will be addressed by the Army Corps of Engineers and the Department of Environmental Quality. If the hearings officer is interested in hearing more about that, there was a sediment analysis done by Mr. Wright. That can be submitted into the record.
Well, honestly, I do not know that I have jurisdiction over the sediment issues.
I would agree with that, but it's not relevant to this application.
And if you're seeking a ruling, I agree. I do not believe that, I would rule that I do not have any jurisdiction with respect to the sediment issues at all. And those don't appear anywhere in Chapter 7 of the LDO, including the ones that are relevant here. And then with respect to the individual who asserted that there are issues that are raised by sediment vis-a-vis the comprehensive plan. I would extend my ruling to that as well, because the courts are very clear that the comprehensive plan sets forth a system of aspirational goals, things that counties and other jurisdictions aspire to. But the comprehensive plan does not set forth a system of laws or regulations or limitations. That is left to the land use ordinance, which is then subject to review, approval, and acknowledgement by the state regulatory agency, the Department of Land Conservation and Development. So I do not believe I have any jurisdiction over sediment. And I'm ruling, I do not have any jurisdiction over sediment.
We'll refrain from discussing that further. With respect to erosion that may occur downstream, that was addressed in Mr. Wright's design study, and was determined that there will be no impacts downstream of the dam for erosion. And other issues that were raised by opponents are not relevant to this application. I'll just add that for the ownership of the
yes. I'm just going to make this wild assumption that you're not inclined to relax the 150-day deadline.
That would be an accurate assumption.
So I shouldn't ask. All right, well, hearing no requests for further submittals, I am going to close the hearing, I'm going to close the record, and I'm going to take this matter under submission, and I will have a decision one way or another by the statutory deadline for this, which is July 26th, which is now, whatever that is, five, 6 weeks from now. You will have a decision by then.